discussing antisocial personality disorder, ASPD for short. We will be focusing mainly on the sociopath in this video because they are the most representative of ASPD. We will address the psychopath in a separate video in the future, so be on the lookout for that one. So let's start by defining what a sociopath is through their characteristics. I'm pretty sure you already have a general idea of what these are, but because everyone at some point or another wished they were a psychopath or a sociopath. But for good measure, I'm just gonna go over them anyway. So first of all, sociopaths and antisocial personalities in general tend to disregard moral values, societal norms, and the feelings of others. Sociopaths have poor impulse control and are very irresponsible and reckless, which results in putting themselves and others in dangerous situations. Also, they have little to no empathy, which results in their willingness to exploit and harm others, including their own family and friends, and they show no guilt or remorse in doing so. They can be very charming also, which is one of the reasons why everyone is so obsessed and fascinated by them. However, they only use their charm to manipulate others for their own personal gains. Their attachments and emotional bonds to others are weak, and their relationships often revolve around manipulating, exploiting, and abusing others. This exploitative and unlawful lifestyle usually leads most sociopaths to end up incarcerated in prison. Now, let's look at some factors that may cause the emergence of this personality type. Well, it seems that lack of parental stimulation and affection plays a major role in the underdevelopment of the child's brain parts that deal with emotions and empathy and the ability to connect to other human beings on an emotional level. So when they grow up, they tend to become sociopathic. From a neurobiological perspective, most antisocial personalities tend to have lower than average response to fear. Their frontal lobe, which is the part of the brain that controls aggression and impulses, has less tissues compared to normal human beings. Their brain may also just not be able to recognize facial expressions that are associated with fear or stress. They also have an overly active dopamine system, which causes them to behave the way they do to get their next dopamine rush. And finally, lower levels of serotonin have also been linked with ASPD. Serotonin is that neurotransmitter that's associated with happiness and well-being. I just want to add also that nowadays, everyone wants to be labeled a psychopath or a sociopath because the culture today is very materialistic and is promoting that stereotype. Many of our prominent figures are antisocial personalities who find great material success and they thrive in our modern culture. And because of their success, they are also capable of shaping and influencing the culture, which results in more antisocial personalities being created through the culture. Now, when it comes to comorbidities for antisocial personalities, the majority of them seem to have issues with substance abuse. This personality type is very addictive. Most of them also have a attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, better known as ADHD. Some also have anxiety disorders, and in a few cases you can also find some of them having depressive disorders. Now, the psychopath and the sociopath are the two main characters of antisocial personality disorder. However, it seems that many people tend to confuse the two terms and use them interchangeably to describe somebody that frustrates them. Let's look at the differences between those two terms. First off, the sociopath is impulsive, irresponsible, and reckless. They are usually considered losers in life or criminals. They make up a large portion of the prison population. They are very emotional, and most of their crimes are going to be because of blind rage or impulsive acts of vengeance. They have poor control over the insanity that's within them. They represent about 4% of the general population. Psychopaths, on the other hand, are very calculating. While they're also irresponsible, they tend to have better self-control. They also tend to better blend in with society. They become, or can become, influential leaders in their organizations, and also major entertainers. They use social respectability as a way of gaining power in their environment. Psychopaths seem cold and almost show no emotion. They won't harm someone unless they stand in their way. Their mental energy is focused on controlling their insanity. This self-control is believed to be something that's genetic. They represent only about 1% of the general population. So, to differentiate between a psychopath and a sociopath, think of it this way. The psychopath will think about the consequences of his actions and plan his crime beforehand. While for the sociopath, they will act just based on his or her feelings, and they usually end up suffering the consequences of their actions and end up having troubles with the law. Psychopaths, however, tend to commit more severe crimes compared to sociopaths. So, I hope that clarified the difference between the psychopath and the sociopath, so that you know which term to use correctly the next time. This sociopath-psychopath model is still the most popular when studying the types of antisocial personalities. However, some people are shifting away from that model. One of those people is an American psychologist named Theodore Millen, who suggested there are 5 subtypes of antisocial personalities. First is the nomadic type, which is an antisocial personality mixed with the schizoid and avoidant types. They are usually wanderers and drifters who go around from place to place, scamming people along the way, creating chaos, and burning all their bridges before moving to someplace else. So, if you're a backpacker, you'll probably end up meeting this type of antisocial personality along your journey. So, watch out for them. The second type is the malevolent type, which is an antisocial mixed with the paranoid personality. They are very sadistic and resentful. They believe people will betray them at some point, so they choose to be the ones to betray first. And because they are sadistic, they take the smallest thing as an excuse to take revenge on people. Many serial killers are from this type. The third type is the covetous antisocial. These are the types of people that want to take away what someone else has just because they don't have it. This is caused mainly by their greedy and envious nature. They are also very passive-aggressive, and deep inside they are very needy. The fourth type is the risk-taking antisocial. This is an antisocial personality mixed with the histrionic type. They are audacious, daring, and reckless. Most people confuse this behavior for adventurousness, but they usually put themselves and others at great risk, with disastrous results. And finally, we have the repetition-defending antisocial. This is an antisocial personality mixed with the narcissistic personality. This type of person wants to be perceived as all-powerful and unbreakable, which is not true. So, they become overreactive every time their image of themselves is questioned. A lot of people confuse the terms psychopath, sociopath, and narcissist. While every antisocial personality has some degree of narcissism, some types have in it more than others. The narcissistic person is different from the psychopath and sociopath in their need to be admired by others, and that need being the central focus of their personality, which is not the case with the antisocial person, who more or less doesn't care about what other people think of them. So that's the difference between narcissistic and antisocial personality. I'll be making a video about the narcissistic personality type in the future, so make sure you are subscribed. Okay, now when it comes to diagnosing ASPD, officially a diagnosis can only be made once the person is 18 years old with symptoms of conduct disorder appearing before the age of 15. In terms of a cure for antisocial personality, well, this type of personality never seeks therapy because they love having power, and they see therapy as putting themselves in a powerless position. Also, therapists don't like to work with this personality type, since they create a struggle in the power dynamic of the therapy session, with the antisocial trying to usurp that power from the therapist through seduction or aggressive behavior. So the therapists in general just avoid working with them altogether. The only way to get an antisocial personality into therapy is through a court order. Also, with ASPD being ecosyntonic, most antisocial personalities don't even think there is something wrong with them. They believe their behavior is perfectly normal, which is another reason why it's very difficult to work with them. The best thing to do for an antisocial person, if they somehow identify that there's a dysfunction in their personality, is to try to self-heal themselves by becoming aware of social norms is very long and difficult, but it's not impossible. Now, I want to ask you, do you know an antisocial person? Have you ever met one? What was your experience like dealing with one of them? I'm interested in people's personal stories and experiences, so I'd love to hear from you. Anyway, this is the end of our video. I hope you found it interesting. See you soon.